I'd like to call this meeting to order and ask that our district clerk lead us in the pledge.
Pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome. May I have a motion, please, that the agenda of Tuesday, August 12, 2014 be approved as submitted?
So moved.
Second.
Questions, comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 7 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. May I have a motion, please, that the board approve the consent agenda that is listed on page 1 of your agenda and page 2?
So moved.
Questions or comments? Thank you. I just want to make one comment, is that under personnel appointments, we are appointing Dr. Leslie Good-Maloney as Penfield High School principal for the year. And we're very excited about this appointment and her working with the students. She comes to us, you know, from Penfield, which is always great. You know, with a great background in instruction, she's our STEM director, and that's a very exciting appointment to us for tonight. So, may all those in favor? 7 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. We have no special reports this evening and no visitors who wish to address the board. The student representative, Aubrey Masters, will be joining us in September. And we now move on to the acting superintendent's report. Dr. Putnam.
Thank you. I have two PHS students to honor tonight, staff student honors. And we also will have a summer update on some of the great work taking place this summer. A presentation around the Skip Flu Project by Mark Sansusi, instructional technology review from Ed Turkowski, our director of technology, as well as a school lunch report from Mr. Joe Argento. And again, back to Mark Sansusi for tax rates for the 2014-15 school year. To get us started, we have two PHS students who earned perfect ACT scores, and we wanted to honor them tonight. They would be incoming seniors, Timothy Dunn and Catherine Yorko, and they both earned a composite score of 36 on the ACT college entrance exam. I just wanted to note that on average, less than 0.1% of students taking the exam earn a perfect score, and obviously the Penfield School District and the Penfield High School are especially proud of these two young scholars. And I will turn it over now to Mr. Jim Pfeiffer for the summer update.
Thank you, Dr. Putnam. I promise I will keep it as brief as possible. Let's talk a couple items here to bring the board and the public up to speed on. The Bay Trail Double Accelerated Math Program, Bay Trail Health Program, Elementary Enrichment, and our Leadership Summit that took place at the end of July. Well, that's not how that's supposed to go. That's better. All right. So back in May, we brought a recommendation to the board to talk about suspending the double accelerated math program at Bay Trail. We had concerns with the implementation of the Common Core learning standards and trying to really pack 3 years of instruction into sixth grade so that students would be able to take integrated or algebra one in seventh grade and then geometry in eighth grade. And those concerns, as we shared with the board and with the public, were due to when the standards were realigned, we no longer had overlap in the standards and we really needed to cover each grade level of standards more succinctly. And so we had multiple parent meetings with regards to that recommendation, and we got a lot of feedback and great input from families and students as well. And we slightly revised our program a little bit to ensure that we were meeting students' needs. And so we are moving forward this year with the schedule, as you see up on your screen. All students who are eligible for accelerated math will be put into sixth grade accelerated math. And during that time, they will cover all of the sixth grade standards and half of the seventh grade standards. And then they'll go on to seventh grade and cover the remainder of the seventh grade standards and all of the eighth grade standards, and then take Algebra 1 in eighth grade. However, if students and parents wish to try to take Algebra as a seventh grader, we will make that opportunity available if they demonstrate adequate readiness. And we do have an assessment to test their readiness toward those standards. We do have right now about 4 students who are as seventh graders we feel are ready to take Algebra and can handle that leap, have demonstrated that they've mastered the seventh and eighth grade standards sufficiently enough. They will be scheduled into Algebra 1 with eighth grade classes. And that will also impact a little bit the rest of their schedule, because they will then take, I think, a special, probably PE, with eighth graders as well. And then that would mean that as eighth graders, if they wish to take geometry, they'll take that first period. We'll schedule a first period class of geometry here at Penfield High School, and then shuttle them back to Bay Trail for the rest of their classes. That could change if, during the course of this school year, we have more students who demonstrate readiness. So if that number goes up, we may be coming and asking to run a section of geometry at Bay Trail next year. But we'll continue to keep an eye on it. We think we've got a good program in place. We've met, Mr. Buddington met with several parents who were concerned about where their child fell within readiness to take algebra. And some are the students who are taking algebra, and others said, you know what, no, we think we're going to hold off and we'll just take the accelerated math. I think it's also important to note that we do have approximately 4 students who did take algebra as seventh graders, but are taking it again as eighth graders, because they didn't feel that they performed well enough and had mastered the content well enough to move on. So they're going to take it again as eighth graders as well. So we will continue to monitor this, and as our students develop their capacities around the Common Core standards and demonstrate a readiness, and as our teachers are ready, then you know we'll revisit the idea of double acceleration again, but we'll continue to make sure that we're doing our best to meet our students' needs. The Bay Trail Health Program, up to, yes?
Just before we move on, board members, do you have any questions or comments?
I just want to, I do want to make a comment about the math, and I want to thank you and your colleagues for working so much with the parents on this. It was, I know, a struggle, and many hours went into it, and I think it was a great example of how you did take their input and work collaboratively, and I thank you for that. I just want to point out, this is more a little bit of a criticism, a comment, than a question, because I understand, and I think a lot of the parents do, why this happened to happen, that it had to happen, and why it had to happen. I just, part of me mourns what we had, and I think it's just an example of losing local control a little bit. We had something really special in Penfield that other school districts didn't have, which was a double accelerated program, and we had it, and other schools that were higher performing didn't have it. We were able to have 2 sections of seniors that were able to take Calc 3, and I really think that our kids were very well prepared in math to go on. But because of the standards shifting and all that, we had to make changes. So I'm also glad to hear that you're, and I know you will be, reevaluating. And I'm just sort of pointing out that it's that sometimes when we talk about a loss of our control and that other factors drive what we thought we were already doing the best thing for students, and I think we were, and I think we're still going to be able to meet their needs, but it's just it's a little bit of a loss to something that we had that was great. Again, not a criticism, just a comment.
Thank you.
Thank you, Camille. Any other questions or comments? Catherine?
Jim, for those who would be going to the high school and then shuttling back to Bay Trail, would that shorten the class time at the high school so they get to school on time? How would that alter class time?
I'm not entirely sure of that. Dr. Putnam may be able to answer that question better, because he was, as when he was principal, they did do that for some students.
Oh, okay.
So I would defer to him on that.
Sure. It's what happens is the Bay Trail day starts later than the high school day.
Mm-hmm.
So the students would ride the high school bus into the high school, and that class would have to be scheduled first period at the high school. They take first period class. We don't have a homeroom or anything first period. So they go right to their first period class. They're there for the entire 40 minutes, and then they get bussed over to Bay Trail.
Okay.
So their schedule is impacted, but there's not a loss of instructional time with that.
Yeah, that's right.
It's been a couple of years since we've done that, but it has been past practice that is how we have been able to support accelerated students at Bay Trail taking high school math classes.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? All right, thank you.
Certainly. Okay, on to the Bay Trail Health Program. Prior to the 13-14 school year, students at Bay Trail took health education for 10 weeks, one out of 3 days each year, 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. And my understanding is the idea behind that model of delivering the 20 weeks of required health at the middle school was to ensure that there was a continuum of health throughout their experience, 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. Some of the feedback that teachers had from that was that the program really ended up being pretty disjointed. It was difficult for them to establish relationships with kids, and with only 10 weeks out of the entire year, one out of 3 days, it wasn't a lot of time with kids. And at the same time with that, as we implemented the Common Core Learning Standards, there was a program there to help readers and help develop reading skills with all students in 7th and 8th grade called Strategic Reading. The administration at Bay Trail felt that with the Common Core Learning Standards and the increasing needs of students, they wanted to restructure that to be able to provide more targeted strategic reading instruction as well. And so the combination of those factors led to some changes to the way health was delivered. We examined that. Last year was really a transition year, and there were some holes in the program for sure as we transitioned to a better model. But through the course of the 13-14 school year, myself and Mary Beth Walker, the PE and health chair, and Winton Buddington met at least a half a dozen times, if not more, and two or three of those times were also with the Bay Trail certified health teachers to revamp the plan and come up with what we believe is a really cohesive plan to ensure that we do still have a continuum of service that provides for more than just what is absolutely required in 20 weeks of health. And that's what you see here on the screen is the new model. So sixth graders will still get health-related content in a course called Personal Development, and that will be delivered by counselors at Bay Trail. There'll be counseling topics that are health-related. There will not be a grade for that class other than perhaps participation, but they'll be scheduled for that for 10 weeks out of the year, one out of 3 days. Then in seventh grade, students will have, this is really the meat of the required 20 weeks of health content, with a health certified teacher all year long, one out of 3 days. So that will allow the teacher and the student to really develop that relationship around those, you know, touchy topics that they're working on in middle school health. And then in eighth grade, we'll be using the results of the Youth Risk Behavior Survey to do seminars similar to what's done at the high school. So to start, we'll use the results of the most recent survey at the high school to work with those eighth graders. We know that the signs of suicide was an area of concern. We know in the media that there's a lot around, you know, concerns around you know, drug use and things of that nature. So we want to be proactive with that. We will also be back on cycle with Bay Trail starting this year with the administering the Youth Risk Behavior Survey every 2 years. This will be the first year of that. So those data sets, along with the behavior data gathered within the school, will be used to drive those seminars, and we'll schedule them as appropriate throughout the year. So we really put a lot of thought and effort into this. I really appreciate the work that Winton Buddington and Mary Beth Walker put into making sure we put together a great model. We've also fully ensured that all of our special education students will get the full health requirement as well through this model. We'll have one teacher who will be pushing into those self-contained classes to collaborate with that special education teacher and integrate health into their curriculum, and then those students who are able will be integrated into the regular health classes in seventh grade as well. So I think we've got a better model. Again, we'll continue to look at this, keep an eye on things, make sure that we're doing the best to meet students' needs in terms of health education.
Thank you. Board members, any questions or comments?
The seventh grade health education that is taught by counselors?
No, seventh grade is certified health teachers.
Certified health teachers. Yep. Which, is it the health?
Sixth grade, personal development will be taught by counselors.
By the counselors. Is that in a classroom setting?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And then the seminars, the eighth grade seminars, is that a classroom setting or is that an assembly?
They may be classroom, they may be auditorium presentations. They'll take a lot of different formats.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions or comments? Thank you. Jim, it would be great, since we're changing, if sometime, I don't know, end of the year, you know, we have a brief presentation again of how this worked out for us and for the students. That would be great.
Okay.
Thank you.
We can do that. Okay. Just an update for the board and the community regarding the elementary enrichment program. Last year, when the board fully staffed our elementary buildings again. We had four elementary enrichment teachers. The model that we employed was that the enrichment teachers at each building worked with identified students in grades 3, 4, and 5 to provide project challenge instruction, so that enrichment instruction every day of the 6-day elementary cycle during the ELA response to intervention block. So that was 30 to 40 minutes depending on the building on a daily basis. In addition to that, those teachers also taught core math for 60 minutes to students in grades 3, 4, and 5 to the highest level math students in each building in each of those three grade levels. And the thought there was, one, we would be addressing math skills and providing math enrichment, which we hadn't done the previous year. It would increase the contact time for those students identified and those high level math students with the enrichment teachers. One of the consequences of that model was that it was a lot of the elementary enrichment teachers' time, and it really restricted them from providing services either direct or indirect to other students, especially at the K-2 level, and that was something we realized as we went through the year. And we also then had a new board policy adopted that really gave us some more direction in terms of the model that the district wanted. And we didn't feel that employing enrichment teachers the way we did last year was meeting the intent of that policy. And I had also received throughout the year some feedback from parents, especially of parents with students in grades K-1 and 2 who were concerned about the lack of service for their children. And so I started with a parent meeting with the PACE group and also did a survey of all elementary parents as well as all elementary teachers and administrators, counselors, psychologists, things of that nature, anybody that might be having contact with students who could potentially be identified, especially those at an early age. And the feedback was very loud and clear that we wanted the public wanted increased service for students and increased opportunity for students at grades K-2. And so we worked with the enrichment teachers as well as with the elementary principals to develop a new service model or a new schedule for the elementary teachers that we felt would better meet everybody's needs. One of the concerns that came out of the work having project challenge every day during the ELA-RTI block was that we weren't really doing anything to develop the skill deficits of those students who were in project challenge. And just because they're identified as gifted doesn't mean that they don't have skill deficits. And then we also weren't, the model didn't allow for the enrichment teachers to provide the RTI math during that block either. So we had some problems with that schedule that we didn't like too much. So this is the adjustment that we've made. So now our enrichment teachers will continue to provide project challenge at grades 3, 4, and 5, and that will continue to be during the ELA-RTI block, but it will not be all 6 days. It will be approximately 3 out of the 6 days. And we use that as kind of a frame of reference until we get things going and we see what the needs are. And then the other 3 of those 6 days, the enrichment teachers will provide ELA skill development opportunities for the kids to make sure we're filling in any deficits that those kids may have. So it'll be a balance of both of those. Similarly, with math, the enrichment teachers will not provide the core math instruction at grades 3, 4, and 5 to the highest level students. They will work with the higher level groups during the math RTI block in grades 4 and 5 only. We needed to pull one of those grade levels off in order to open up their schedule enough to provide time for K-1 and 2 activities and the whole school type activities. And so you'll see they'll be doing some whole class enrichment units in grades K-1 and 2 for about 6 to 8 weeks, roughly speaking. They'll work with the K-1 and 2 teachers to schedule a time when they can come in for about 6 to 8 weeks and do these enrichment type units. This will help the enrichment teachers get to know the kids. It will facilitate into the screening process. And if there are students who are really rising above the rest, then the enrichment teachers know which classroom teachers they need to do some collaboration with, or maybe even provide some direct services with throughout the course of the year. So we really feel like this is far more reflective of our board policy in terms of the type of program that we want to have. And in the end of the month, when I share another update with you about some of the work, I'll share some of the curriculum work that the enrichment teachers have been doing as well.
Thank you. Board members, questions or comments about enrichment? Camille?
I still don't understand for K-2. Mm-hmm. I love that they're going to see the kids. I love that it's the whole class, and I think it will help them in the identification process later. So if you're in kindergarten, in 1 year you'll have a 6 to 8 week unit, or you'll have several 6 to 8 week, or because
We haven't set parameters on how many. I'm thinking right now it'll probably be one throughout, you know, at some point throughout the year, and it may stretch beyond that depending on timing. But there'll also be that we're working with the enrichment teachers to plan whole school opportunities. So as we bring in, say, a presenter or an activity through the Arts and Education program, they might do something that might span multiple grade levels that will include K-1 and 2 and could involve those students as well. But right now, we're probably looking at 1 6- to 8-week unit a year per class at each level.
Okay, and the whole school, that's sort of like the Bay Trail model. They do a lot of that, bringing in a whole, you know.
Right, and it'll be interesting to see how we can work that out. Obviously, the schedule at the elementary level isn't quite as flexible. But one of the other changes that's been made is we now have an enrichment chairperson again. Restructured some of the leadership at the elementary level, and Carrie Young, who was the lead enrichment teacher at Bay Trail, applied for and was a successful candidate to be the enrichment chair. So I'm really excited to have her expertise help continue to build that program and really align it to the Bay Trail program and prepare students for that as well. So it's an exciting time.
And her title is enrichment chair K-12?
K-12.
It is,
yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Excellent. Barb?
Jim, I'm very excited about the whole class piece for the direct and indirect service. Here's my question, though. Our special needs classes, are they being included at all?
Like, I would say that they should be, yes, and we'll have to continue to plan for that. But it should be open to all students.
Okay.
So,
and is your support service at all working with the enrichment teachers, like you know, your speech pathologists or your OTPT?
I don't know that they're pushing in with them at all during any of those classes. I guess it would depend on student need. If there was a need for that, then we would try to work that out. But I know that they are working a lot of times during the RTI blocks with kids and you know, providing services in that regard too. So it's really about scheduling as well and when
right,
we can
right.
fit everybody in.
Right, right. But very excited about that. Thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions or comments? Great, thank you.
And last but not least, the Leadership Summit, formerly known as Leadership Retreat, and I've stumbled over that a few times myself, but we're trying to get there. So on July 30th and 31st, we had approximately 80 teacher leaders and administrators convene for 2 days at St. John Fisher College. We reviewed the district strategic plan and really dug into that a little bit about what it meant and where the impetus of that plan was, its connections with professional learning communities, its connections with the Office of Instruction Action Plan, as well as the Professional Learning Plan. We dug into growth mindsets and leadership and how essential it is for we as the educational leaders of the district to really model a growth mindset for our teachers in turn to be modeling that and developing that within our students. Reviewed some of Carol Dweck's work in that regard. We talked a lot about effective professional learning community leadership, what it means to be an effective PLC leader, and really just scratched the surface on how to handle some of the challenging situations that can come up along with that as a PLC leader. And then the second half of the second day was devoted to the beginning of the school action plan development, formerly known as school improvement plans. So principals and leadership teams got together to start developing those plans. Unfortunately, with the timing of the retreat, we didn't yet have our assessment scores, which only came out today and won't be public until the end of the week. But we may look at the timing of the retreat in the future to see if we can push it back, but we get so close, we never know when these scores are going to come out. That's difficult to do. But I will say there was a tremendous amount of positive feedback with the board presence there at the summit this year. It was great to see everybody there, and we appreciated the kind words of support, and it was definitely noticed and appreciated by the teacher leaders and administrators there. So thank you for the continued support.
Thank you. Board members, any questions, comments? Mark?
I just want to say that we went there not only to show support, but it was also valuable for us. I mean, there's a lot of people, a lot of faculty who we don't get to really know in just our usual routines. We had an opportunity to sit down and talk to them at breakfast, and it was just very important for us to really get to know them, and also for them to get to be comfortable around us. Yeah, thanks. To get to be comfortable around us, to know that we're not off limits and, you know, beyond approach. So I appreciate being included in that.
Great, thank you. It's good to know it was beneficial both ways.
Yeah.
We'll plan for you. We can plan for you to be there longer in the future if you have some extra time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
Thank you.
You're welcome. I think we covered all the questions, so we're good.
We did.
Before we turn to Mark, if it's all right, I just wanted to just publicly thank Jim and also the team that planned that leadership summit. Assistant principals Charlie Rudes and Terry Febre, and there's one more I don't want to remember.
We had Lynn Rainey.
Lynn Rainey
was there as well, and Kevin Swartz.
Thank you, and Kevin Swartz. So just a lot of planning went into that, and Jim's presentation did a nice overview, but talk about countless hours of preparing for that. He did just a wonderful job, so thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. With that, I'd like to update the board on an ongoing partnership. It's ongoing and it's also new. So that is the school SCIP, school kids influenza prevention program. And this is ongoing in that, probably unbeknownst to you, we've been participating in this for a couple of years, but as a control school. So essentially, nothing happened, but as part of this particular study, our data with regard to influenza rates has been part of the work. We're moving forward in that partnership, and we're going to be taking a more active role in the 14-15 school year. And what this is a partnership between the Monroe County Health Department, the University of Rochester, who has a study grant for development of this program, and a variety of elementary schools, including Brighton, Penfield, and a few others. And what the intention is to develop an in-school influenza vaccination program. The goal is to increase the rate of vaccination for elementary age students, which is about 50%, and it hasn't budged. And so we know that that besides the impact on schools that influenza can cause, certainly absenteeism, it can also be very dangerous for younger folks and for folks at home. So there's certainly a need and an intention to reduce that. And the idea is that an influenza program, a vaccination program, and this would be the MIST, not the not shots, but that an in-school program would increase availability. Certainly, we all know that flu vaccinations are available at pharmacies and doctor's offices and so on, and yet the rate's only at 50%. So the thought is to see if an in-school program could increase those rates. So the process will be a development of a web-based consent system that's being done by the Department of Health and University of Rochester. But it would also include a parent reminder system that's independent of us, and then on particular days we'd release students for an influenza vaccination program in school, so they'd go down to the nurse's office, or we'll have to find out how many we're going to have. We'll work through some of those details, but they would get their MIST in school. And of course the idea is to work out the bugs on a small scale, and be able to roll that out countywide, and then eventually nationwide. All of our elementary schools will be participating, but they'll be paired. So each one of our elementary schools will be paired with a control school. So essentially, two of our schools will end up offering the vaccinations, two won't, and then the study will compare influenza rates between the elementaries. We don't know who's going to be what yet because they haven't been assigned, but that'll be an early part of the process. So last year, in 13-14, it was piloted. We'll continue to expand it. During this year, 15-16, the program's expected to expand even further into Monroe County, and then 16-17 and beyond, they intend to be able to replicate and use what they've learned to hopefully increase those vaccination rates. You see here the key collaborators. Currently, the schools that are participating are Brighton, Pittsford, Spencerport, East Irondequoit, Churchville, and Greece. And you see the other community partners, so the Department of Health, University of Rochester really taking the lead, Department Children's Institute, they've contracted with Comet Informatics to build the web-based permit or permission system. And of course, primary care practices throughout the county are going to know about this and be participating. So we just wanted to bring you up to date on that. It's we're in the very early processes right now. We've agreed to participate. The school nurses have had conversations about this and are starting to get ready. So we'll see it rolling out, and we would expect the first communications really in September and October as we start to move into flu season. So
right,
if there's any questions,
I'll... Questions or comments? Catherine?
Do you know yet whether or not payment is going to be part of this? I know, like you go to the drugstore, they still want your insurance
they
card.
Still
want,
and that will still be part of it.
Okay.
So there are a variety of, there are a variety in the community of free vaccination opportunities, and I think that'll be part of this as well.
Okay.
But certainly I think it will be fee-based if you can pay.
Okay, so if insurance is part of the equation for a particular student, do you know how that's going to be handled yet?
It won't be handled by us. That'll be handled through this system that
okay.
they're developing.
Okay, I was just curious about that. I'm sure parents would want to know about that too, but they would have all that information.
Correct.
Yeah, okay.
Catherine, I was nodding because I just got the announcement for e-news, and there's a series of insurances that are accepted, the most common ones. But for anybody without insurance, it's $40 fee.
Okay.
If people just want to pay to get the vaccine.
Okay.
Okay. I do want to clarify something. This is optional, right?
For us? Yeah. Oh, for the students, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, certainly, yes.
I just want to clarify, because we're saying, the information is great, but I just want to clarify for the public who is watching this that this is optional,
oh,
even
absolutely.
Though we are part
yes.
of the study.
Yes, no, it's completely
well,
voluntary.
You never know. I don't want somebody to,
Yeah, it's
get
sort
the
of
wrong
shades
impression,
of,
so.
Of George Eastman lining everyone up for their tonsils out. But no, it is completely voluntary.
All right, thank you.
I have another question, then.
Sure, Captain.
Do you happen to know, Mark, whether or not with any of the students that or schools that have already participated, if it's had any effect on the rate of flu in those schools?
I don't know
okay.
that.
Okay, all right. That's probably just information that's going to be forthcoming.
Yeah, and I think it's a little bit early for
yeah.
them really to make that judgment.
Oh, yeah, I think so, too. But I just thought if you knew, that would be great. But thank you.
Thank you. Mark?
Will there be a component that involves collecting information about students who get vaccinated outside of school? If you're looking at the vaccination rates, mm-hmm. We've got a certain number of students who elect to do it within school, but then outside of school. Do we have to collect that information?
We do not, and I don't see how that would be collected because it is voluntary,
mm-hmm.
And we don't have that information. So if parents choose to avail themselves of the information, they'll log on, they'll register to their students, they'll give the appropriate permissions. Those would be students who weren't vaccinated, but we don't have any way of closing that other loop. That's not part of our responsibility. We don't have access to that data.
Okay. Thank you.
John?
The university may have. I mean, because, 60% of the people that go through the community to get flu shots go through the U of R, so they may be thinking on those terms. But the other piece, too, that I think is great on this, when Carol talked about the communications to the parents, I mean, this is a leadership event that we're participating in, and the university usually is good at rolling out the press on this, but we should also just stay in tune with it because it's big for our community to know that we're trying to do something that is different, and this is a big issue. When October rolls around, these are news stories, so just something to think about for us to communicate.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? All right, thank you.
Next up, we've got the instructional technology services. So I'll ask Mr. Turkowski to come up and provide an overview of the instructional technology services we have at Penfield Central Schools. It's a great presentation.
Thanks, Jim.
With a lot of information on what we currently have and looking towards the future as well. So I'll thank Ed.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to share
some of the work that we do regarding technology, especially in, with the focus tonight of being the instructional side of technology. And because all of the work that we do, our department, the Technology Services Department does revolve around kids and how students can use technology to enhance their growth in education and their growth in learning. So we'll touch a little bit upon the administrative side and probably a little bit of technical stuff just to show you how everything is supported, how each part supports one another. Here's some of the guiding principles that we use for around technology. We want our students to be career and college ready. So we know in ubiquitous technology today is everywhere. We want to make sure that our students, when they leave the district, are prepared and they're familiar with those different types of technology and how it can be used to enhance their learning as they move forward out into the world. We use it for such things as enhancing reading, writing, obviously, speaking, listening, online resources that provide useful information for them in their studies, understanding the various weaknesses and strengths of technology and what technologies may or may not be appropriate for any projects or work that they're pursuing. How to effectively use technology to communicate their ideas. Looking at digital content to solve mathematical problems, things that we do on a smart board where students can view equations in more of a dynamic fashion that the smart board allows them to portray those. And then just other concepts that they can understand their mathematical concepts a little bit deeper, utilizing a lot of the various resources that are available. Technology information, these are just some of a brief overview, just some of the different ways that we use technology. Research databases are big. Students start out at the elementary level using things like NoodleBib, NoodleTools, using some age-appropriate resources, online databases through the libraries, and they begin to learn how to do research and how to look for information that's been vetted. And that is from scholarly databases. And then as they move up into towards high school, the databases that they use become more sophisticated, probably on the level of what they'll see in college. A lot of those, when they leave here, they'll see those same names when they get to the college level and have to start writing papers or in other vocational programs as well when they have to start doing research. We have an instructional enhancement. Different websites like the Khan Academy where kids can go and students can learn more about particular topics, videos that they can access that might just explain something a little bit differently than that they might otherwise have heard, and so that they can use that to enhance the learning that they already have. So we use a lot of specialized software like Read and Write Gold and Kurzweil that help students that might need a little bit of help with their writing, or they might need a little bit of help with their reading in enhancing and building their reading skills. We have the Futures Project, which is growing exponentially. It's the blending learning environment. We use our technology to help support that type of program. Project Lead the Way, which is our engineering program. Students are heavily involved in CAD programs. They use real-world CAD programs to be able to learn how to use those programs so that when they move out into the world, they already have an exposure to those programs. The music program, we still have a lot of great instruments out there, but there's a digital portion to that as well, where kids are using digital computers to synthesize music and combining both of those worlds and coming up with some fantastic things. Same thing with the art program. Students, we have a digital photography, we have film studies, where kids are building, learning to use all of those digital technologies to create different types of art form. But we still have the good old clay and all the drawing and all of those important things as well. So we have a unique blend of both worlds that are really important. So that's a little bit about how we might use technology instructionally. It's kind of infused throughout everything the whole day. But just to give you a little bit of an idea what that technology actually is. And it's a little hard to see, but you've seen this before. This is a breakout of the types of technology we have, everything from computers down to telephones, interactive whiteboards. And you'll see we've grown exponentially. In 2007, we had approximately 2,700 pieces of equipment. We then jumped in 2012 up to about 6,000 pieces of equipment. And right about now, we stand at about 6,500 different pieces of instructional equipment that are available to students and staff and teachers to support the educational program. The majority of it, if you see, is based in computers. We've been very fortunate with over just about 3,400, a little over 3,400 computers that are available to our students across the district and staff, because there's administrative in there as well. But we've been very fortunate with your support that we've been able to maintain our five-year replacement cycle. These laptops, they get used. When you start seeing them in year four and five, they're really being heavily used, and they're being used for the right purposes. Kids are touching this stuff. They're using it. We also strive on some of our more of the infrastructural kinds of things. We strive to maintain our 5 to 10 year replacement cycle with it. So we appreciate your continued support to keep these resources and that investment, to keep those resources available to kids, to keep them working so that they are getting used. So we have technology, so how do we make it useful? Well, we have to attach it to something. This is where we get a little bit more of the technical thing. We have about 8 miles of fiber optic cable that connect all of our schools together and connects us to BOCES, who is then our internet service provider, who then connects us to the internet. We have high-speed connections. We have what we call 10 gigabit and 1 gigabit connections. All of our instructional buildings are 10 gig. And think about 10 gig, it's just bandwidth, it's capacity to be able to move information back and forth. We have much more capacity available to us because what we're trying to do, we just did an upgrade last year and finishing it this year, this summer. We're trying to future-proof our connections and our infrastructure to the internet because we know that that's going to grow. There was a study, national study done around broadband, and that was their suggestion. We were able to meet that capacity, but again, we're looking forward. What are going to be the needs in the next probably around 10 years? So that's what we're trying to build towards, is being able to make sure that we future-proof the technology that we have so those laptops are usable for something other than just writing. We also have a large wireless. We've pretty much blanketed the entire district with wireless coverage. We've upgraded to the latest radios to give us, again, more capacity, because we find kids are engaged in videos and online. There's a lot of kids using a lot of resources all at one time, so we've upgraded those radios. We'll continue to monitor the performance of it. We have high hopes. We have a lot of redundancy built into the system. You can kind of make it out there. There's a couple of red boxes. They back up one another, so that should there be an outage and should one of those devices fail, the other one will take its place and instruction can continue without too much interruption. This wireless system also allows us to move carts around the buildings. Each building has carts of laptops that move from room to room to room, because we know that labs get filled up, they get booked up really quickly, but yet a classroom doesn't need it. We don't have a whole set in there all the time because they're not used 100%. So we move them from classroom to classroom at this point in time, and that allows them to get used quite heavily. They're pretty much used every day, all day long. Next piece of our infrastructure that's related to instruction is our storage array. We have a storage SAN, which is nothing more than just a big computer that houses all of our files and data. 23 terabytes of storage, that's just a huge amount of information that we can store and maintain, but we maintain that. We connect that back to BOCES, again with our large connections, so that the availability of information and shared and stored documents is almost is instantaneous with the setup we have. So the infrastructure itself can kind of fade in the background, and that allows the instruction to move to the foreground. That's a little bit about the instructional side. Want to talk just a little bit more about the administrative and operational side of our technology. We're going to look a little bit at safety and security and communications. Security. Our department, we manage the security cameras district-wide, interior, exterior. We manage that, making sure that cameras stay up and running. We have managed a short-term video storage. We have X amount of days of video that we can store to go back and look at. We also split the access control system where, you know, you take your badge out and you swipe in. We work with buildings and grounds on that and managing that system because it runs across our network, runs across those backbones, those big capacities that we've talked about. Later this year, and you'll be hearing more about this in the future, we're looking to implement the visitor management system that was part of the district-wide security project. You'll be hearing more about that in coming weeks and months. And we're going to be heavily involved in, we're heavily involved in getting that project off the ground and up and running. Service continuity and safety. This is, it, you know, this box sits out in back of the building and we kind of don't pay much attention to it until the lights go out. And then we pay really close attention to it. But it's service continuity, it keeps the lights going, but it's also a safety factor. Because what that allows us to do is, the high, in this case, the high school is the core. Everybody, all the buildings connect back to the high school. This allows us to keep the phone systems running. This allows us to keep limited computers running, because we can't power everything. But it allows us to keep some of those core services around safety going. And we hope to be able to move that out to the other buildings as time goes by to get those core services on either a generator. And in this case, we have these huge UPSs. They're big banks of batteries. And what they do is they allow a significant amount of time for all of our equipment, and it's a room full, all of that equipment to continue to run without any power coming in from the power company until that generator kicks in. We can go quite a while, but usually the generator kicks in about 35 seconds or so. Everything switches back over. The equipment has no idea. The phones work. The computers work in limited parts of the building. The phones work across the district or across the buildings. But this provides us that measure of safety that we have those resources available when we really need them. Along with that, we have communications. We recently upgraded, a few years back, we recently upgraded what used to take up about a half a room full of equipment is now just a few pieces in a rack, a technology rack. It's a hybrid system, meaning that it's some of the old-fashioned analog phones still on the wall, and there's some of the newer fancy phones. But what we did is we were able to maximize, by going with a hybrid system like this, we were able to maximize our investment, reutilizing all the wiring in the walls. But again, this system, to provide that communication, this system relies on our fiber optics that we share across the district. We rely on our generators to be able to power those systems in times of outage and to get us through that transition time between when the power goes out and when the generators kick in, we have those UPSs powering these systems. So all of this is really tied together. We have a lot of complex equipment, so how do we support it? Well, we have a great support staff. I can't tell you. These folks are wonderful. We have one senior network technician, five network technicians, a secretary, and myself. These folks, they keep it going. I don't know how they do it. They're always upbeat. They're there to help out. They just show up, and they work their magic. I gave up on trying to understand their magic because these guys are just, and gals are just wonderful people. They're very valuable to the district. And they're also very, very busy, as you'll see. So how do we keep this all going? How do we know what's going on? Because we have all of this stuff, if you will, sitting out there. Well, we use technology ourselves to be able to support the technology that we're providing to the students and staff and teachers. We use a product called What's Up Gold. It's a monitoring tool. It runs in the background. It's checking each and every piece of equipment constantly throughout the day and night, year-round. If something runs out of we set up parameters. If something falls out of that parameter, it automatically sends us a text message or an email that goes to each and every one of us on our team. It goes to all of us. We all get it 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We know what's going on. On certain critical components, we even share those alerts with buildings and grounds. Say, for instance, if there's an air conditioning failure in one of the closets, temperature rises, their staff will get an alert to be able to come out and fix it. So we have to utilize these tools because of what we're trying to keep track of. Now, to help support that from the user, from the end, from teachers and staff, we have a help desk. We have three different ways that they can access it. We have an access portal, which is web-based. They can log in and put in their ticket, their request for help. They can call our helpline that we have and leave a voicemail, and this system will automatically take the voicemail and create a ticket for them. And we also can utilize, they can send an email message to a special address, and that address will then generate a ticket for it. The nice thing about this system, this web help desk, is that that ticket immediately goes to the technician. It shows up on their phone, and it's not unusual for somebody to put a ticket in and have a tech walk in the door a minute or two later because they happen to be right down the hallway. And often people are surprised that we were able to respond that quick. Well, they happen to be walking by. So we really encourage people to utilize that help desk. It also keeps them apprised of as different activities occur. As work is occurring, the techs will update these tickets, and it notifies individuals immediately through via email. Here's what we're doing to resolve your issue. Last year, those six people handled over 6,100 tickets. And I say around, because I could pull a number out, but I know that there's a lot of, hey, could you stop in here for just a second? So I like to use the 10%. It's probably 10% more. It's just math is easier for me to do. But I know it's at least 6,100 documented tickets that it happened last year. And it's been fairly consistent over the last few years. Lastly, on the support side, we use a product called LandDesk, and that allows us to manage those 3,500 computers. Somebody needs a piece of software, we can click a few buttons, it sends that software out. But make no mistake about it, there's a lot of times when people have to, that technicians just gotta walk down to the room, gotta touch the machine, gotta make it happen. But we try to maximize our efficiency as much as we can because it's a big project to keep everything going. So how do we know? We know what's going on today by utilizing all these systems. What about the future? Well, we do a couple of different things to look at future-proofing ourselves again. We have an instructional technology request proposal form, and it's a written document that if a teacher, staff, or administrator has an idea about some new technology that they'd like to experiment and pilot and try with, well, we ask them to fill out a form that talks about what kinds of equipment do they need, how do they plan to use it, what are their short-term outcomes, what are their long-term expected short-term outcomes, and what are their expected long-term outcomes. That document is then shared with the Assistant Superintendent for Instruction, his cabinet. It gets reviewed. If it passes muster at that level, then purchases would be made and we would take. So we're buying technology, we're exploring new things with a purpose, not just to have it. It's a purpose behind what we're trying to do. We do environmental scanning. A lot of the administration, a lot of myself, we're we're reading, we're talking to other, I'm talking to other directors, what are they doing? We're constantly talking to vendors, we're reading journals, we're looking for what's out there over the horizon. And by working with teachers and staff in the administration, we try to find those best ideas that we can try to look at or that we want to take a look at to move our district forward around instructional technology. It does provide us with a unique opportunity to look at innovation. To recap just a little bit, the focus for us is on instruction and technology resources. We want to be able to maintain, we want to be able to maintain the administrative side, and we strive to keep that backbone, to keep those infrastructures, the stuff that's in the walls and in closets that people never see up and running. And we also want to make sure that we identify innovative opportunities to be able to support the instructional program. Questions that I can...
Thank you, Ed. Board members, questions or comments? Barb.
Ed. How do I get on to my iPad when I'm sitting in here? Because
you got to put in a ticket.
We can help you with that.
I thought you could. Okay, thanks.
Mark?
I just want to thank you for coming because this is something we've taken for granted so much. We talked more about roofs and transformers in the past year than we've talked about this, and this is not a luxury, and really we're talking about college and career ready, we absolutely have to have this. And you know, it does so much for us, and it, as you've talked about, it allows us to do things we're looking at in the future. When you look at the futures program, which would have a lot of video bandwidth requirements, you're building for that. And for the students, what I see with my children, and I think others, it also helps them act in a much more self-directed way. Mm-hmm. When you have opportunities to go work with computers and do things online, they can follow their own path and find what's interesting to them and not have to have a teacher who's got a compass in a certain area to explore. So this is really, I mean, just, I think, underappreciated for what it can do for us.
Thank you, Mark. John?
Great presentation. I know at the audit committee a couple years ago, we looked at the all the laptops, and we got great grades by the auditors when we did that audit on security and passwords. Is there a concern in this day and age now, a couple years later, in regard to security or threats that you see?
It's probably the same or more so, and I think it's more of it is out in public. You hear a lot more of the stories going on, the breaches, that are security breaches that are taking place. And the challenge is we did great then, but we got to continue to do great today. We have to continue to move that forward, plus add more to it to be able to make sure that we are secure. We take security is really is probably one of the most important things that we are concerned about, is making sure that the information is safe, where the kids go is safe, and that nobody can get in. So we're constantly challenged by that, and we're constantly watching it. But yes, I think a lot of it's becoming more public. It seems like every week you can read about something new. So it's always on the forefront of our minds. Thank you.
Catherine?
You referred to a study that made a suggestion about how much
bandwidth
storage you needed. Okay. In that study, or are there other studies that indicate how relevant the material or the technology we have now is going to be maintained into the future? In other words, are we looking at any kind of obsolete technology that we have now that we're going to have to address in the future?
Actually, I think one of them is behind you up on the wall there.
Uh-huh.
We've moved away from the analog video with the cable. We now, like morning announcements used to be broadcast through the analog system. It's all digitized now.
Okay.
So there are some technologies that we're kind of abandoning. But we're with that, by looking, doing that environmental scanning, we're trying to understand
what's coming up.
There's Gartner, there's called the Magic Quadrant. There's a group that does studies, and they kind of foreshadow what's going to happen.
Yeah,
we kind of watch it. Yeah,
right. That's kind of my question.
Kind of watch on the wave.
Okay, so but there's no major anything on the horizon that they've alluded to.
Not that I've seen lately.
Okay.
No, I think the things that are going to, you know, the video conferencing is going to become more, the blended learning
mm-hmm.
is going to take precedence. You know, it's like email, kind of text now, and you know they use other formats to communicate. They're not, so some of those technologies will start.
Okay,
start to
so
wane.
It seems like there's a little bit of a transition, but nothing dramatic.
There's nothing dramatic that we're seeing at this point in time.
Okay. All right, good. Well, thank you.
Any other questions? Lisa?
Did I do that right? Okay. I'm curious. I know, like, my children have mm-hmm. almost, you know, we have two iPads in the house, and I'm mm-hmm. thinking a lot of students are going to be, especially as years increase, bringing their own personal devices in mm-hmm. here. Do we have thoughts how we might support that in terms of, you know, if a teacher has a certain lesson they want to download to that personal device, and then those obviously they don't stay here, so there might be some security issues around that. But it also, I think, could help our resources as well, because then parents are providing those types of devices anyway.
We are currently looking at a couple of different platforms to be able to. We see that coming. We see the cloud as the next big thing that's going to be coming down the path, and how do we manage that? How do we handle that? We're doing a couple of that. We're looking at some programs right now that will allow students to be able to, or teachers to download, and students to be able to access files and folders when they're not here. A lot of teachers do use their classroom web pages to be able to share information back and forth. around BYOD. We've kind of played with that, or we have some flavor of it right now. We do run a guest wireless network that students can connect to. They have, but it's accessible, but it's password protected as well. So a student has to have their credentials, their network credentials, and I'll share those with you. They have their network credentials that allows them to take their device and connect it to ours. But what we found is even a thing like having their phone takes up resources. It's still talking to that thing hanging up on the ceiling. I think one day last year we found like 1,700 devices that people had brought in that were connected to it, which took resources away from the instructional resource. So we're trying to figure out what that balance is to allow students to do the BYOD, but yet make our resources available to the instructional side for our equipment as well. So it's a balancing.
All right. That's it. I guess you already answered my question, because I was wondering about bandwidth with you know, all the students that we have and being
challenge.
Able to connect.
It's a challenge
so
for us.
Thank you for answering it. I think we've come a long way from over 10 years ago when all the discussions used to be Apple or PC. What do we go with?
Well, they still
what
are
should
there.
We do?
You
know.
Still have those.
So that's interesting. Thank you so much. We don't get to see you very often, but thank you for a very thorough presentation.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ed. Next in our presentation, Mr. Argento around the school lunch program and what we're looking at in the upcoming school year. And I'll just mention to the board, Mr. Argento's been working hard because he comes from Cobbles this evening for our Strive for Five program, where the incoming kindergartners and their parents get to hear about the lunch program and then get on a bus and ride from Cobbles to Harris Hill and learn about bus safety. So I had an opportunity before I came over to just say hello to those parents, because I got to do that the last 2 years in a row with my kids as they reached kindergartners over the last 2 years. And so I've seen the program, and he does a very nice job, and I know this information is very insightful, too, for this school year. So thanks for being here, Joe.
Thank you. Thanks for coming tonight, and just so the board knows, we had quite the turnout, so it is well attended, and we have to thank Gina and all of her staff for showing up there tonight, directing parents and getting everybody up on the buses, especially in inclement weather here.
Yeah.
So everyone was still very excited. We had a very strong turnout, and we will do it again tomorrow night. Hopefully we have another strong showing. So here tonight to talk to you about our school lunch program and our successes, challenges going forward, and how we're doing. Forecast last year, we built a budget. We worked off of our actual sales, our actual eight lunch sales was $324,000. We built this year's budget for 2013-2014 based on that participation. We didn't get the amount of meals sold. We didn't meet that goal specifically, and we'll explain that. We had a little lower ADP than we had hoped for. In the end, it still made for a solid school year. You know, there is this year we did have a little drop off. We had a little bit of build up years prior, and you know, I think there's some trends that are going on. But you know, it was still a decent school year. We did have three days this school year where we were closed. You know, for snow days. We also had some power disruptions throughout the school year, one at Harris Hill that impacted us towards the end of the year. And these impact, you know, our total meals sold. We lost about, at least with the three closures, we lost about 5,000, an opportunity for about 5,000 meals to be sold based on our current ADP. So when school closes, you know, that hurts that total number. think we're seeing a little bit of, you know, that we did see a little bit of change in the way the students are using the program. I mean, we still have a very strong participation rate is based on, you know, if you look at our participation rate in other suburban schools, we do get good participation rates in the program. We also have a lot of kids that just like to buy a la carte stuff. You know, that's buying with their feet or choosing with their feet. Maybe they don't like what's on that day and they run over and get something else. And we also seen some impacts with the meal pattern changes. I kind of say this, you know, tentatively, because I think there are kids out there that just don't like the fact that they have to take something or they have to have something. I don't want this. I'm not used to that. And I think that is something that's kind of happening. The other kind of just goes with the trend where students, as they get older, they kind of like that freedom of just buying whatever they want. And you can kind of tie these things together. And so you see a little bit of that hitting us, and nationally, we're seeing this happen also, that the Healthy Hunger Act is, you know, other districts are reporting, you know, loss in participation, basically just because we're forcing kids to take things now. Yeah, granted, they are healthier meals and choices, but sometimes there's some resistance there when you tell somebody they have to take something. As I mentioned earlier, it was still a very good school year on the revenue end. We had expected about a $51,000 profit. The amount of revenues and expenditures we had were very realistic to the budget that we had built and presented to the board. Obviously, selling less meals, we had a lower supply usage and material usage, a little bit lower usage in labor. But the amount of money that we made was very accurate to the amount of participation that we had. Going forward into this next budget year, our thoughts are that the participation is going to remain the same. We consistently do this year to year. I kind of work off of the actuals of every school year and forecast whatever percentage increases I'm going to see. It's around bids, you know, our bids currently are just going up slightly. We're also, we had a little bit of a decrease this year with employee benefits. We have materials and supply I'm expecting a little decrease in that budget line because I'm forecasting this school year to be to sell at a lower ADP. We're also going to have some more reauthorization provisions that are going to hit this school year, and we'll get to those. When you look at this budget that comes to the board, the revenues and expenditures decrease slightly budget to budget. Building this year's budget off the actual meals that we sold in this school year, $310,000 is what we're estimating for this year. This year's ADP, based on our school days, I'm anticipating 1,717 meals a day as part of our ADP. Kind of forecasting, this is a newer way for us to do it, but Mark and I had a little discussions that, you know, we lost 3 serving days this year, and when going forward, we should kind of anticipate that. This way, at least there's no real shock as to why we didn't hit our total meals sold. So when we looked at this budget, we kind of took that into consideration, you know, that if we have any days that were closed and we lose some sales. So that was kind of one of the themes in putting this budget together. And again, I want to talk about the new provisions that we're going to see this year. As a reminder, last year we had to increase offerings. This is last year's provisions. We increased our offerings of grains at breakfast. You know, there was 3 components that had to be taken in our meals. The fruit and vegetable component was a must be taken. That's going to show up again this year. That's going to show up at breakfast. 50% of our grains had to come from a whole grain source. We had specific vegetable groups that had to be offered and had to be menued weekly. And we also had maximums with in servings between grains and proteins. USDA did back off a little on that rule because it was just such a challenge to come up to hit all those components, especially considering the way the industry didn't have a lot of time to adjust their products. So they did back off on that in January, and we were able to loosen that up a little bit. This year, going into specifically the provisions this year, at breakfast, we do have to offer a cup of a fruit or vegetable at breakfast, and they have to take at least a half a cup. So similar to last year at lunch, the kids are going to have to take that component along with the others that we offer. When we offer four components, they have to take three. 100% of our grains have to be from a whole grain source that we offer. So last year was 50%, this year it's 100%. This is pastas, this is breads, this is even in snacks. Everything has to come from a whole grain source. Speaking of snacks, we are also going to see this year nutritional guidelines and standards that are going to apply not only to the snacks that are sold outside the school meal program, but on the school campus and during and throughout the school lunch day. So this is going to impact the program just a little bit. Kids are just going to see a little bit different things offered. We still have some forms of ice cream, chip snacks, and beverages, but there's just going to be they're going to fall under specific guidelines in order for us to offer them. This year, to help offset some of the increases that we're gonna see a little bit increase in the cost of producing a breakfast. So we're proposing a 15-cent increase at breakfast because we're gonna have to offer the fruit and vegetable component that has to be taken. So we're gonna see an increase in cost there. Fresh fruit becomes expensive. It's about a quarter that we see on our end. If we go to a canned version, it could get stagnant. And I'm not a huge fan of canned goods, but they do fit in the program. Going to propose a slight increase at lunch, a nickel. This is what's going to help to offset some of the costs that we're going to see in the grain products. That was one of the things that I saw in the bids. The whole grain products are a little more expensive, and predominantly I saw some of that of our bread products going up in cost. So to help offset that, we're proposing a nickel. Reduced price lunch, we want to remain offering that free, and same with breakfast. You look at Penfield School District, countywide to some of our touching districts here. We do remain one of the lowest at offering in breakfast. Lunch at both levels, we are one of the lower ones, not just with this group that you see here, but other districts around these districts here. Also, our price of milk, we're going to remain that at 50 cents. Questions?
Thank you. Board members, questions, comments? Catherine?
I think you and I share the same sentiment about the force of, forcing the kids to, I don't like that at all. But anyway, that's not my question. You mentioned that when we were talking about the 100% of grains must be from a whole grain source, and you said that's going to have an impact on ice cream. It's not cause and effect with that.
No.
So what is the difference with the ice cream? You said that there will be an impact on what kind of ice cream you can offer.
Yeah, ice cream is now the criteria that the ice cream is going to fall under is any of the novelties that we offer. They have to be they have to fit the following criteria. They have to be less than 200 calories per serving. And 30% of those calories have to be, less than 35% of them calories have to come from the total fat. And then you've got 10% that has to come from, 10% of that is only allowed to come from saturated fat. And then sugar is 35% of the weight of the item.
Okay.
And then lastly, it has to be less than or equal to 200 milligrams of sodium. So it's a very tight window when you specifically get into ice cream or even get into your salty snack. So it's...
Well, and will you be able to serve real ice cream, or is it going to be like artificial
ice cream? No, it's going to be real ice cream.
Okay.
It's just going to be a real small...
Little piece. Yeah, but yeah, real little thing of ice cream. Yeah, two little bites of ice cream.
You know, and they're, the Perry's is the vendor that won our bid, and they're working very, very hard to try and come up with formulations that fall into these guidelines. And... You know, they have a reduced calorie, or lower fat, low fat milk ice cream, but they're very tiny.
Well, I think portions. Tiny portions is better than if it's real.
Yes.
Than a bigger fake portion,
mm-hmm.
because a lot of people are, they think it's sugar free and it's healthy. Well,
mm-hmm.
that just means there's something fake in there that's
Correct.
Making it sweet. So. You know, with our kids growing and all that, I would rather see them buy two small things of something real than the other. So, but when you mentioned specifically the ice cream, it got me thinking. So thanks for the clarification. All right, thanks.
All right, thank you. Any other questions, John?
You should see me at the yogurt place when they weigh it by the pound.
I know.
I have to like take half of it back. Probably not the right thing to do, but I know the function of our profitability is based, and I know Mark's reiterated this, on our contribution, the general fund transfer, mm-hmm. and that's for benefits, correct? And I think the nice part is, it's $190,000 a year that we subsidize it, but the number is going down gradually, which I think is great. You know, so I think the price change is important. I mean, I know we're never going to get to zero on it, but we're not going the other way as far as the general fund subsidy, I guess, in that
yeah.
regard. So I think that's a good piece of all this for our community to know as well, that, you know, we believe in it, we think it's good, we subsidize it ourselves, but it's not out of control and it's nudging down. So I think that's a positive note.
Thank you, John. Any other questions or comments? I do have a quick question for you
sure.
regarding scheduling at the high
sure.
school. For those students that take very rigorous schedules, how is it possible to accommodate their lunch periods? Many times you hear from parents that mm-hmm. their kid does not have a lunch period just because when they have a free, the cafeteria is not open. So how do we do that?
Wow, I don't really work around the schedules.
I can help you out, I think.
I'd steer towards the building
sure.
administration.
If you don't mind, in my former life as high school principal just a month ago, believe it or not, a common occurrence where students will pack their schedule. We highly recommend that they have a lunch. A few years ago, maybe my first 4 years ago as principal, I tried to mandate it, and that doesn't work because parents and students are very strong-willed in wanting to take as many classes as they can. That being said, the cafeteria and the commons for the upperclassmen and cafeteria for grade 9 and 10 are very accommodating, and so are the teachers. So while what we have provided the students, and all we need to do, the student just has to talk to their teacher, is basically a front-of-the-line pass. And so they create a pass, and those students come down, they can get to the front of the line to buy their lunch and then get to class. And the classroom teacher accept typically science classes, and that is because there's typically a state mandate around food during the lab period. But they know that those students that don't have all lunch period built into their schedule, will be bringing food into their classroom. So the cafeteria and common staff are great with the front of the line ticket, so they don't have to wait in line, because that can take some time and they'll be even more late to class. And also the cafeteria and commons, for people not at the high school, there's two cafeterias here, one on either end of the building. And so cafeteria is supposed to just be for 9th and 10th graders, but they're very accommodating if you have a senior who needs to pick up lunch, because that's the cafeteria closest to their classroom. And so they, Joe's staff is wonderful at keeping an eye on those kids. One of the big pieces I would say for parents watching is, if you do have a student without a lunch, we're not necessarily always proactive to go saying, do you need the hot pass? Do you need to get lunch? If we know about it, we do, but it does fall on the student at the high school to say, I need some help getting lunch, and then we're there to make it work.
Okay. So how is that communicating to the parents? Because, for example, the parent and me, three kids at the high school, that's a first for me.
Yeah, so that'll be a job for the high school principal. No, I think it usually is passed along. I will tell you that many times it is a conversation with the counselor around the schedule. And there are many times that students are aware of it but don't necessarily take advantage of it. But okay. What I can do is share with Dr. Maloney, now that she's official as our principal, is a reminder with those schedules for counselors to talk with the students, as well as the assistant principals, to talk with the students about their schedule and what they can do to help. So.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I mean, there's always this struggle where we want the kids to be healthy, not skip a meal, and, you know, we really want them to have their lunch. On the other hand, it's, oh, there's all these wonderful classes, rigorous classes. Right. If you want to take them, you can't eat. So it's always a struggle there. So,
You know, wanted to just, again, thank Joe for being here. It's one of those pieces where if you don't work in public education, the rules and regulations around what we can offer and how we can offer it are mind-boggling. And you know, having worked with Joe as a principal, he's on top of it. And so that's really what I would like the board to be aware of. There's a lot of regulations. And while you asked about ice cream, I will say on public record, my first email was to Mark Sansouci on, will I still have Pop-Tarts? So the answer is yes, but only certain kinds that fit into those criteria that Joe mentioned. Yeah. So thanks, Joe.
Yes, Catherine.
Well, and to, you know, jump off of that, Camille and I, the year before last, on information exchange, we had a whole presentation on what the entire Monroe County, obviously it's the state, has to go through and that was a year and a half ago. And so now you have even more challenges. Oh, but yeah. I found it so challenging back then. It really kind of made my head spin to think that your hands are really tied before you're even out of the gate. And
yes.
And then you have to please the kids who are very hard to please.
Yes.
And then you have a lot of mandates that don't even make sense. So I have to commend you.
It's like trying to control gravy with your fingers.
It is, yeah.
But I do want to add, and I didn't mention it earlier. I was going to save it for the end here. We did have an administrative review that was done by the State Education Department, Division of Child Nutrition. They're the cookie cops that the USDA sends down to say, is Penfield compliant? Are they juggling the gravy here? Are they doing everything? And it's a two-part review. There was an off-site and an on-site. I won't get into it. It was very extensive. It took about 40 hours just to go through the off-site part on my end, loading information into Ed's wonderful technology. Thank you, Ed. And loading the information into the computer, sending it to USDA, sending it to the Child Nutrition, New York State Child Nutrition. And then they came on site, and then they actually looked at the program. And they found us to be compliant. They found our food to be appealing to students. They found it to look fresh. The staff was very knowledgeable on what was going on. So
It's not only just me, it's my entire staff, and obviously the support that we get from the board every year. We appreciate that. But I was very excited that process was over, and that they were very pleased with what their findings were. We had very minor things that they would like, you know, wanted us to change, signage and minuscule things compared to all the regulations that we're up against. So I owe that. I owe a lot of that to my staff, and I will pat myself on the shoulder later. But I do thank you for the opportunity.
You can do it now. It's okay.
But I do thank the board for the opportunity, and thank Mark for his help throughout the year as well. So,
and thank
the rest
you
of the PSA.
Thank you, Joey. We don't get to see you often. It's also one
I know
of those annual visits, but we always appreciate it and appreciate the update. Thank you for all
thank
of
you
your
very
hard
much
work.
The last presentation within the superintendent's report is back to Dr. Sansusi around our tax rate.
Thank you. Just wanted to give the board and the public information on this year's tax rate. August is the meeting at which we are obligated to establish a tax rate for the upcoming school year. So at the June meeting, we had a presentation with sort of with a thorough review of where we anticipated ending the year in terms of fund balance, year-end transfers, and so on. So you see a recap of that and an expansion of that in more detail in tonight's agenda. I'm not going to go through that again, but rather just because we're on track with what we presented in June. So in fact, we are proposing approximately $900,000 less in transfers. We end up in about the same place as we proposed for, as we discussed at that June meeting. So I want to focus really on the three main numbers that go into building the tax rate for tonight. That's the appropriated reduced taxes, as we committed to in the budget documentation that went to the public. We're proposing approximately $2 million, $2,071,000 in appropriations as a revenue against the levy. The levy is $50,000 less than what we had, that is what we, the appropriated tax amount is what we had discussed in the budget documentation. Our levy's about $50,000 less due to some increased revenues, and we recommend that we maintain the undesignated fund balance at 4% of budget. So with those key factors and all the other information that you see in your agenda, we end up here with regard to tax rates. And the one thing that is different from what we have discussed and what we presented in our budget documentation has to do with the equalization rate in the town of Brighton. So as we moved through this process in August, we became aware that the state of New York has paying the equalization rate for the town of Brighton at 98%. What that means is essentially that that assessments in the town of Brighton are changing at less than what the market value of the property is, so that the market values in Brighton are growing faster than assessments are changing. And the net result of that is determined by the State Department of Equalization and Assessment. One of the forms you fill out when you buy or sell a house is that form on sale where you report the value. All that information is collected, testing's done, it's analyzed statistically, and that determination is made. So at this point in Brighton, the judgment of the state is that the assessment, it represents about 98% of the market value. So that changes the tax rate in that town. You'll see that tax rates are around $25.49, just under a 1% increase in all of our towns, slightly less than that in the two towns in Wayne County, Macedon and Walworth, but about a 76 cent per thousand or 3% increase in the town of Brighton. And really that change, that difference, is all driven by that change in the equalization rate. So we, in terms of the levy, we are at where we are at where we projected and where we told the public that we would be, or we're at our approved levy. The rates in five of the six towns are lower than what we had projected in the budget documentation. We're about 1.5% over what we had projected for the town of Brighton. So we've gone through this before. The town, in order for this to be corrected, the town eventually needs to reassess. That's a decision up to the town, but typically it's not done quickly and certainly not done every year. So the last time we went through a sort of this kind of cycle, it was 4 or 5 years before that occurred. So I don't know what their intentions are, but it's going to drive this kind of challenge for us, I think, for the next several years.
Thank you, Mark. Board members, questions or comments? Mark.
Yeah. I understand why Brighton has a different tax rate because of that equalization.
Correct.
You explained.
The intention is, I'm sorry, I just wanted to say, I probably should have been clear about this. The intention of that is that any homeowner, because we have components of six towns in the Penfield School District, and assessment practices vary across all six of those towns, or could vary across all six of those towns. So what this math is intended to do is ensure that the owner of a $100,000, or as an example, a $100,000 home with a market value of $100,000, no matter what their assessment, they should pay approximately the same tax bill. And that's what this does. So it provides equity across the towns, although it doesn't often seem that way.
So the question is, all the others have the same equalization rate. Why is the tax rate different for the first three versus the last two, as well as the change?
Because one of the other components of this calculation has to do with the sharing of sales tax. So sales tax a credit in Monroe County. It's also a credit in Wayne, but it's the proportional difference between the two.
Perfect. Thank you.
John?
And you're all welcome, for those of us in Brighton. And it's a good news, bad news scenario. Mark and I talked about this because we were all surprised by this. I know the schools were, for sure, and because the state really just drops this on you. And, you know, I think it's important we just sort of have a note under this to our, you know, to the community members in Brighton, whatever. It's not something we're doing. It's basically we have no control over it.
Correct.
And for years, I remember we were well below what the other towns were too, but you never know when they're going to do an assessment. It's a political item too, as well as a town board expense, but this happens from New York State from time to time. So again, it's a good news, bad news scenario for everyone in Brighton, because sales are up, average sale price or median sale price is up, but this is what happens, so.
Camille? Oh, I just wanted to, usually when we, or sometimes when we show the tax rate, we'll show an example, like you mentioned, a $100,000 house. So if I were living in Brighton, would I expect a tax increase? You know, how, can you put a dollar figure back of the envelope,
sure,
dollar figure, and what they might expect?
It's 76 cents. Their increase is 76 cents per thousand of assessed valuation. So a $100,000 house would be 76 cents or $76.
Right. Thanks.
Thank you. Any additional questions or comments?
All right. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Okay. This concludes the superintendent's report. We now move on, board members, to page 3 of your agenda. Financial items. In your packet was a recommended lunch fund budget for 2014-2015 school year. May I have a motion, please, that the lunch fund budget for 2014-2015, as recommended by the Food Service Department, be approved?
So moved.
Questions or comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 7 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. 2014-2015 school lunch prices. The following price schedule for students for 2014-2015 is recommended. We do have a slight increase In breakfast for students full price, we have a 15 cent increase, and for students who buy their breakfast at reduced price, there is no change. For lunch in elementary and secondary, we have a 5 cent increase, and for anybody who are buying at reduced price, there is no change. Extra milk has no change. May I have a motion, please, that approval be given to the Food Service Department for prices of school meals as listed above for the 2014-2015 school year?
Second.
Questions or comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 7 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. Establishing the tax rate for 2014-2015 and funding reserves. We just had a brief presentation from Mark, and I am not going to read the several pages we have here. However, I will ask for a motion that the above 2014-2015 anticipated revenue budget be amended as described in your agenda, that the described transfers and adjustment be approved, and that the school rate for the 2014-2015 school year be calculated on a real property tax levy of $58,535,391.
Second.
Questions or comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 7 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. Policy review. The district code of conduct was included in our packet, and Marsha indicated in the email that came to us that there were no comments in this regard. So may I have a motion, please, that the district code of conduct be approved as presented July 8, 2014?
So moved.
Thank you. Now, there were some questions in emails in regards to wording and everything. Have we cleared that out? Are we?
I think that we're comfortable moving to a one word. One word doesn't change the impact, but it was enjoyed to have. And
okay.
So we'll make that change, I think. And
very good.
Yep.
Thank you. All those in favor? 7 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. President's remarks, I don't have a lot. I just have a major thank you for John, Mark, and Camille for our workshop and organizing it. I think it was pretty good for the first time. You know, we had a workshop with our administrators, you know, really talked about lots of things, and I think we've accomplished a lot, and that was really great. I also want to thank all of you for, and that includes senior staff also, and Dr. Patton for responding to the doodle regarding the next workshop. I know this is not the best date for, you know, a lot of us, but thank you so much for reorganizing schedules and all of this. That adds more on our agendas, but you know, it's always, we learn a lot, we plan a lot during those workshops, and those are great. So thank you. And we now move on to unfinished business. Committee assignments are listed in your agenda. I hope everybody's happy with what you got. Since then, I've heard from Mark Ellidge, who will be our legislative representative at New York State School Board Convention. So that, thank you, Mark. We really appreciate this. You know, you're being at the business meeting and also at that meeting in Canandaigua to represent us there, and you know, that is great. I also heard from Barb Babiars, who will be our special education representative, looking at all the special education packets. So thank you very much for doing this again, Barb, for us. And I think we've got all of this for now. Any questions about the unfinished business? Very well. New business. We received an email from Monroe County School Boards regarding survey discussion that I have forwarded to you. So I want to open up this discussion right now. That email was also included in the back of your packet if you want to take a look at it. So what do you think? And this was, you know, for the benefit of the public regarding the topics to be discussed at Information Exchange and Labor Relations Committees for this year. Camille, I know you had some suggestions regarding Information Exchange, so do you want to start?
Yeah, well, and actually, I think all of us can reply, although I think Lisa and I will be in the room to advocate for specifically for any programs that we want other than the ones listed there. The urban suburban program, which Penfield is one of seven school districts that participate in this, and there are 19 school districts, so we're in an elite group, and I think it's wonderful that we participate. Urban Suburban is celebrating its 50th anniversary in June of 2015. So hopefully this year there'll be, you'll hear some celebrations, including in Penfield there may be some. But a lot of people in our community and board members don't really know how the program works, how the selection process works, you know, what does it cost to a district, things like that. So I was thinking that would be a great year for information exchange to have the board members learn about Urban Suburban. So I would advocate that for that at the meeting, but if you all put that in your survey, then that's nice too. And then Lisa had some ideas too about topics for information exchange.
Yes, just based on our workshop that Carol had just mentioned, some of the things that we had talked about was leadership development in the district and keeping and growing talent was one of the thoughts I had, and also internal Board of Ed, professional development, self-assessment, kinds of things we had talked about. So,
thank you. Any additional topics? All right. I'm going to ask that, you know, each one of you responds to this to Monroe County School Board. And if you have any additional topic you can think of that you want to add, please feel free to do so in letting them know what is of interest to our board. And for, again, the benefit of the public, for information exchange, there is CTE STEM interests, effective support systems for students, avoiding board pitfalls, school safety plans, best practices roundtable, and issues with social media. Those are proposed topics from a survey that was circulated last spring between the members. Now, regarding labor relations, the proposed topic from last spring are controlling health insurance costs, retiree health insurance, preparing superintendent contracts, negotiation trends, RASP update for the October 15th. There will be a presentation on tenure by Ron Mendrick from Harder Seacrest and Emory. Any additional topic that you would like labor relations to entertain?
I can't think of an additional one, but I've been on labor relations, and that RASP update is great, and I think that you don't want to miss out on that opportunity.
Okay. Thank you, Camille. Any other comments?
I have a question.
I'm not quite sure then. I thought that, okay, so as individuals, we're going to get back to Sherry about this?
I think it will be good if we did that.
Okay.
Yes, because when you're sitting in a room, you know, people get votes, so yeah.
Okay.
I think it would be a good idea. So if I can ask you to please do this by the end of this week so that we don't forget about it,
All right.
That would be great. Any additional comments or suggestions or anything like that? All right. Barb, yes.
I just want to say that after 7 years being on the school board, it's going to be nice to finally be involved with Monroe County School Boards, because I haven't been able to because all of their meetings have been during the school day. Now I can go.
Well, that's great. I'm
going to be on the labor relations.
You will enjoy those meetings very much. We learn a lot there, so thank you. All right, and I do want to point out, just from talking with Jody, that those meetings, while we are appointed to a committee, each one of us, everything is open to just about anybody. You can just RSVP that you would like to attend and, you know, go if you are interested with any topic. So don't feel because you're appointed to this committee that you cannot attend, you know, any other topic that is on another committee. So, yes, John.
And as co-chair of the legislative committee, I'm looking for now those that can come, huge participation in our trips to Albany. Possibly our superintendent might like my personalized tour of Albany that I've done in the past here, but I think it's important that we focus on that more than ever as it comes out. And as you know, we have to show up in force and strength when we do that. So looking forward to at least one newcomer and hopefully more newcomers on the couple of trips to Albany. Thanks.
I will bring you my two classes of college students, definitely in force. All right. Yes, Camille.
Lisa asked me because I said that the RASH was a good idea for an update, and she said, well, what's RASH, which is a great question. And so for everybody's knowledge, that's the health consortium that Penfield is part of. And Penfield was a real prime mover in getting that going. I think Dr. Sansusi's on their executive committee. And so with the changes in healthcare that are happening, it does change every year, and that's why it's great to hear what the latest is. So healthcare consortium is RASH. Thank you.
Thank you, Camille. Any other questions or comments? All right. There being no further business, may I have a motion, please, that the meeting be adjourned at 8:40 p.m.?
Second.
Questions, comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 7 in favor, none opposed. Thank you.